As you all know that I have you had read my introduction in the WhatsApp, so have been invited here to talk on the topic of sports psychology. So you can actually see the presentation what I have prepared for today. So if you see the presentation, you'll get an idea of what we are going to cover today. So to start off with, I'll be talking about where the sports psychology came from, after which I'll be going to what exactly is sports psychology. After which I'll be next dealing with why do we need sports psychology? Why do we think it's important to have sports psychology? Apart from that, we will also study how actually sports psychology help the athletes and also the general population. The last but not the least would be about how sports psychology has a future and it can be led to something where you people can pick it up and make it as a career. So I'll be talking about how you can create a future using the subject of sports psychology. So this is the agenda for today. So we'll be starting off by seeing the history of the sports psychology. So yeah, even before that, just to make sure that you all know me, if you haven't read about me in the WhatsApp group which was posted. So I am Mansa. I teach sports psychology in Jain University. We have PG diploma in sports psychology in Jain University. So I teach students there. Apart from that, I'm also pursuing my PhD in the same subject, that is sports psychology. And my topic of interest is to test or to try to see how intervention, that is especially counseling is helpful to athletes. So especially these athletes whom I'm dealing with are the ones who play for state levels and national level games. They are from different backgrounds, like, you know, they are from different backgrounds, different sports. So I'm trying to put in the counseling into the sports, into the athletes, and trying to see how it actually helps them to perform better. So as we all know, physical thing is already taken care by the coaches. So physical fitness is perfectly taken care by coaches. When it comes to mental health, coaches do try to train them mentally. They try to give their boost or try to say that, you know, confidence boost by telling them that they can do it or giving them positive vibes or trying to help them to have a self-talk. So they do bits and pieces. But as a psychologist, since we are from the field of psychology and since we are dealing with humans every day, especially with their mental health, it will be more useful to the athlete when it comes from our point of view. So that's what I want to prove, and that's how I'm working on. So my PhD topic is REBT intervention on sports athletes. So this is my introduction. So I teach in Jain University, and I work also I'm connected to few of the academies where sports training goes on. So I talk to the coaches as well as the athletes. As of now, it's all online due to the lockdown, but otherwise I do visit the academies personally and train the athletes. So this is about me. Now going into the topic of sports psychology. So before even going, you would ask me why should we know the history? Because knowing the history of psychology will let you show the way towards the forward. If we don't know the past, it will be difficult to predict the future. So once you know what history is, where it comes from, you will be knowing where it's heading to. So that's the reason why I thought during the start of the presentation, I thought should I include history or not? But then I thought it's important for you to know the history, how it started, where it started, to actually plan your careers in sports psychology. So that's the reason why I've taken up the topic of history. So when it comes to history, we will talk about when did it all begin. So when I say began, it actually means two parts, as it's shown here. It's history throughout the world and also history in India. So why are we seeing it in two parts? Because history throughout the world, actually, the sports psychology began way ahead. It began when compared to when it began in India. So that's the reason why I've differentiated into two things. So if you actually try to see how it started in the history of the world, you can see how it came to Olympics. And then if you see India, you will see that we are still yet to come with the proper structure, and actually we are in the growing stage. If you see in the world, it has grown quite an extent, but when you see the history in India, it's still very niche. So that's the reason I thought talking about history makes it a lot of difference. So getting into it, there are actually six periods which I'm going to talk about to know how sports psychology came from. So let's go into each period one by one and see where it all began. So the first is it started in the early years of 1895. So please note the year, it's 1895, which is way too early. when you see the Indian history, you'll understand that we are actually lagging behind. So this started in North America. So sports psychology began in 1890s. So it was not actually sports psychology. It's more of how psychologists were trying to see how the sports or how the physical activity will affect the mental performance. This is what they are trying to see. They did not actually have a term called sports psychology. So in 1899, Scripture, E.W. Scripture of Yale, he describes personality traits. So he tried to connect personality traits to sports participation. So that was also not against sports psychology. That was trying to study the psychology by trying to connect it to the other parts of the human life. Then G.T.W. Patrick, so he was also an American psychologist. He also discussed on psychology of play. So he wanted to see how play can affect the personality of a person and also the the child, and also see how the child is developing using the act of play. Then it is Cummins. So he's a cognitive scientist who assesses motor reactions, attention, abilities as to pertain to sports. So they try to study the sports setting now, but it was more to do with cognitive functions rather than the performance. So then 1918, as a student, that is when Coleman Griffith conducted informal. So Coleman Griffith is an important person in sports psychology because he was the one who actually went to the players and started conducting study, and he started it and he took it a longer way. So this is the period one. Now going into the period two, you have from 1921 to 1938, where Griffith published almost 25 research articles. And this time he started calling it as sports psychology. That's when the field actually emerged and it started making sense. Then in 1925, you see University of Illinois research in athletics laboratory is established. And this is again, Griffith is appointed as a director because he was the one working the most in the field. Colin Griffith also published Psychology of Coaching. He also published one more book in next 2 years, that is Psychology of Athletes. So first he studied how coaching happens. Then he also studied how it affects the athletes. So he has done quite a lot of work. So that's the reason why Coleman Griffith is one person which you have to remember about sports psychology. Then they were preparing for future from 39 to 65. So here Franklin Henry assumes the position of Department of Physical Education, University of California at Berkeley, and establishes Psychology of Physical Activity graduate program. So 1938 was the officially start of the physical, the sports psychology as a course, as a graduate program. Till now, it was only happening through research papers. Now it started as a graduate program where people can go and study about sports psychology. In 1949, Warren Johnson assesses pre-competitive emotions of athletes. This time they really went on field and started working with giving them questionnaires. So they made questionnaires exclusively for sports people and started giving it to them. Before this, all the questionnaires which were used in psychology was given to the sports athletes. So there was no exclusivity in there. So after 1948, they started getting the exclusivity where they started to study about sports psychology and then make up questionnaires which fits in for the athletes. And then in 1951, if you see, John Lather writes Psychology of Coaching. So there were many more books which came up. And in 65, First World Congress of Sports Psychology was held in Rome. So that is the time when they actually thought people around the world who are into sports psychology should come up and start making groups. So that was the period three. And period four is establishment of academic sports psychology. So in 1966, clinical psychologist Bruce Ogilvie and Thomas Tutko, they write Problem of Athletes, and also they taught how to handle them. And they also started beginning the consultation. So the whole point of consultation till them, they were only studying it. They were not actually giving trainings. But in 1966, they started training them and giving consultation to athletes and teams. So in 1967, B. Kratty, he wrote the book of Psychology of Physical Activity. And 67, the same year, there was a publication, the conference which happened, and there was a publication of Animal NASTSP. So these are the different groups which was formed which was formed in a national associate level, where people would come and present their papers, which are exclusively for sports psychology. So this means that when I say that there was a conference happening and people would come, that means the word was spreading across the world, saying that there is sports psychology and people can actually go and work with sports psychology. So anyone who aspired to become a psychologist, they got to know that there's a component called as sports psychology, which is the new upcoming field, and they could work on it. So then period 5 is little like, you know, recent one, that is 1978 to 2000. This is a very important era because they started seeing how multidisciplinary science and practice can be implemented with sports and exercise psychology. So they started mixing up with different things. For example, they brought nutrition into the category. They started bringing biomechanics into the category. So not only coaching, apart from this, they were trying to get a lot of other fields into the concept of sports. And sports psychology was also one of the prominent one which held a place with all these categories. So Journal of Sports Psychology was established in 1980. US Olympic Committee developed Sports Psychology Advisory Board. And in 1984, American television covered the Olympic Games emphasizes on sports psychology. So 84 was when actually the American television covered the whole thing and started saying to people that psychology is important even in Olympic Games. And in 1985, the US Olympic Committee hires the first full-time. So till then, there were psychologists who were working as part-time, but then they got an appointed and sports psychology, which was full-time. And this person would be with Olympic Committee forever, like, you know, for the whole, wherever the tour they went, whichever places they went, wherever training they went. So all those times they would have one sports psychologist with them. And then there was an association formed. Again, it was American Association for Sports Psychology. Then the US Olympic team is accompanied by officially recognized sports psychologists for the first time. So this was the first team. US team was the first team to come up with the concept of sports psychology and also get a sports psychologist along with them for the first time into the games. So the others who came for the Olympics were really like, you know, it was a little new to them. And it was an eye-opener also. Then they thought that, okay, this is a nice thing, even we should implement it. After which in 1989, Journal of Applied Sports Psychology begins. And later they established something called a certified consultant as a designation so that people could get the degree and get that position to become a sports psychologist. The last period which we are studying is the contemporary, the stage we are in currently. So the journey of sports psychology and exercise is developed now and is published in Europe. So Europe also came into the picture, and Europe is fully functional as we see it as sports psychologists. They have their own, for every team, they have their own sports psychologist. If you actually see a lot of international players, especially from the Western countries and also these developed countries, they do have sports psychologists with them for sure, because most of them have got to know the importance of having a sports psychology with the team. So in 2005, International Society of Sports Psychology conference in Australia had almost 700 participants from 70 countries. So these countries, 700 participants were all into sports psychology, which is a huge number, because when the time it started and the way it went on, to get 700 participants in 2005 is actually a great thing, because many people are knowing it's important. And also, it also means that these people are seeing future in being a sports psychologist. So concerns emerged about the best way for preparing and educating students. So they started thinking what's the best way to prepare sports psychologists and also give them good education on sports psychology. So then APA, which is American Psychological Association, Division 47, started focusing on only sports psychology as a specialized competency area. So that's when people started, other people who were only into counseling or industrial or clinical, they also got to know that there's something called a sports psychology, which can also be called as specialization. So exercise psychology flourished, and especially in university environments, driven by external finding possibilities, by its utility in facilitating wellness and holding down healthcare costs. So there were strong and diverse sustained research programs which were evident throughout the world. So if we got to know that from throughout the world, the way that they were responding was something which made the sports psychology career as something very promising, because most of them thought this is where you can actually find a place to stay and work and also grow. So that is a brief about how sports psychology started and also saw itself a particular platform when it came into existence. So this is about the world. So now let's get into India, because knowing how it is in India is also very important. If you just know about the world, it's not enough. You should know where exactly we are in India. So if you see in India, it is extremely young. As I told you, it's still evolving. So let's say if they say that 1890s is when the sports psychology started, we are still in 1920s or 30s. We are still in that stage. We haven't still evolved as the other countries or the developed countries have evolved. So one could state that it's in the early phase. As I told you, we're still in that very early phase. So until 1960s, we see a scarce application of science to the area of sports in India. And also we got our independence only in 1940. So after which we were trying to concentrate on making sure people are getting food, people are able to have their livelihood, make sure that they're getting a job and getting an earning. So India didn't actually concentrate on improving sports per se. So India wanted to make sure that people in India are fed 3 times a day, are able to lead a healthy life, are able to get the education. After which India started spreading out and started seeing sports. And right now, it's very much willing to host games, very much willing to send the ones who have the skills to international levels, very much supportive in giving them whatever they want, building up training things, government itself coming forward and making sure that these people who are in the backward classes or who are in the rural sections get what they need when they are really good in the sport. So the government itself has begun to emerge and trying to involve itself to make the best out of it. So we must understand that we are still in the starting stage, but there is a growth. So when we know it's a starting state, there are two things. One, yes, it's challenging because we are still in the starting state. But the other one, the good thing is that there's a long way to go. And if we are in it, we can definitely see a future in it because it's growing. So there was a lot of there is a few research studies which are done. But not really a lot. When you compare it with counseling or industrial psychology or clinical psychology, researches done in sports psychology is very, very, very scarce. So if you actually go to Google Scholar and type sports psychology in India, you can hardly find papers. So this is where the gap is. Please make sure if you're a student, if you are thinking of getting into research and trying to publish a paper, sports psychology is one particular place where you can definitely go for it and do it. And anything you try to do it in Indian setting is something very new and we need it now. So in abroad, they must have done a lot of studies. Try to see what they have done and try to put the same thing in India and see how it works. Because in the way our society works is very different from the way the society in abroad works. So in India, as just to sum up, we are still lagging very much behind. But that's a good thing because we have a lot of future in it. So that's about the history. Now going into the... So now going into what is sports psychology. So we will get into the next topic, which we will talk about what is sports psychology. If you here see, you can see Kobe Bryant. So he's a very famous person whom we lost recently. And this basketball player, NBC players, is very famous and we love him for his quotes and the way he tries to communicate. We are kind of impressed by him. So the one who was behind his success or maybe behind the way he would come up was the sports psychologist who was Mumford. So John Mumford was a person who was behind Kobe, and Kobe himself admitted saying that, yes, I have taken help from sports psychologist and it has helped me in my game. So this means that there's a proof that it does definitely works. So when an athlete tries to tell you that does it really work, you have live examples. I've just taken one, but you have a million examples out there to say that they really work. And people who have been in the elite, when I say elite, the topmost position of the sports in their careers, have actually taken help from sports psychologists and they've admitted as well. So there's nothing to shy away from. There's nothing to feel bad about it. They're actually happy to admit that their performance increased because of having a consultation with a sports psychologist. And now it has been told, especially because the world has gone ahead of us. So people who are ahead of us are trying to prove that there's only 20% of your effort which is physical. So you getting trained, long times of training amounts only for 20%, But after the training, how you perform in the game is 80% your mental strength, or how you think, your thought process, or maybe about your emotions, how you're able to control it. So when you stand there in the game, in the competition, when you are not very confident, when you're not really feeling good about yourself, when you have self-doubts, how much ever training you have taken, by the time the self-doubt pops in, all the training just vanishes and there are a lot of chances of you getting into errors. So that's the amount of importance which is being placed on sports psychology. So what is sports psychology, if you ask me? Sports psychology is the study of how psychological factors influence sports. In a simple way, psychology put into sports is sports psychology. So you're trying to study psychology in a sports setting. So it can also be that to influence the sports, to see how the sports or the team can be influenced, and then also to improve the athletic performance and also exercise and physical activity. Why have we combined exercise and physical activity into the sports psychology? Because there are two things which we sports psychologists do here. One, we work with the athletes to improve their performance, which we all know. The second one, which people don't really know, is we also try to work with the general population to help them get into a physical activity mode or an exercise mode. The reason? Because again, mental health, as much as sports psychology gets affected by the mental health also needs some kind of physical exercise to actually perform the best. So we try to give awareness to the general population, inculcate the point of exercising in them so that they are mentally fit. So these are the two things which sports psychologists do. We usually have an assumption that sports psychologists are the ones who only work with athletes, which is completely wrong. They work with athletes, yes, but they also have another part with the normal people where they try to, because since we are into sports psychology, we definitely know how a physical will help the mental, exercise, and how the mental exercise will help the physical exercise. We know how the brain gets stimulated when a person goes into physical exercise. We know that how physical exercises can make a person feel better or feel refreshed. So when we know so much, it's important for us to spread the awareness to the non-sports people also, because there are a lot of people who are not into sports, not into exercise, but are striving to become mentally healthy, and they are missing out the major step, that is the physical exercise. So we try to do that as well. So sports psychologists investigate how participating in sports can improve health and well-being. They also help athletes utilize psychology to improve their sports performance and mental well-being. This is a very known one, which most people know it. So they also help like regular people, as I told you, to learn how to enjoy sports and learn to stick to the exercise program. Yes, this is one more important thing. We try to help them to adhere. Adhere means to stick to the program which they have thought that they would go to exercise or they would do some kind of physical activity. For example, if someone is planning to go to a gym and if they're not able to stick to it, sports psychologists can actually help them with that too. This is something which most people aren't aware of, but let me tell you, this is also something which we do. So then, now coming to the next one. So what are the topics that are under sports psychology? If you take up sports psychology, what are the things that you can expect? So sports psychology is a diverse field. As I told you, that's one field which has a lot of sectors under it. There are a number of different topics that are of special interest to sports psychologists. Some professional focus on specific areas while others try to study wide range of techniques. So I am trying to concentrate my study in a specific area. So my research involves resilience and trying to reduce anxiety and also help to person to understand about perfectionism. These are my topics. So I'm kind of specializing myself to only to those topics. But there are other sports psychologists who try to have a wide range of things and they try to interconnect each other and try to see how it affects the performance. So getting into each one of it one by one. So first one, if you actually see, the first one is attentional focus. Next one is motivation and team building. Visualization and goal setting. Then you have motivation and team building. Then you have anxiety and rehab. These are not just the one. These are the broad topics under which there are again 10 to 15 topics under each of it. So I'm just going to discuss few of the very important ones and something which is well known. So attention focus is nothing but ability to tune out distractions. So why is this important for the sports people? Because they want to get into something called a zone. So if you are a sports person, you would definitely want to get into the zone, because zone is where they can perform the best. So to get into the zone, you have to avoid distractions. You should make sure that you're giving 100% of your concentration and focus, so that you will be able to give your performance the best. So that, to help you enter the zone, to make sure you know how to enter it, is where the attentional focus will come. These psychologists will try to make sure that the attention that you're paying is given 100% at that particular time, so that you enter the zone. Then next you have visualization. Visualization has something called as imagery. So we try to make sure that, you know, the person who is into the game, we try to make them imagine the real situation even before the real situation occurs, where the person will mentally be prepared for the real situation when it happens. So this has a lot of visualization, where they try to think, imagine things which haven't happened, but they think that it is happening, so that when they go into the field, they won't really be anxious, or they won't really feel surprised, because they have already played it in their head. So then you have motivation. Motivation is very important. And this is also important. We should also remember how coach and the athletes share a very good relationship. So if you have to improve their performance, it's important to have a good relationship. If they're not really having a good relationship, the athlete will not be motivated to perform, and the coach will not be motivated to help the athlete. So this way, we try to make sure that both of them are motivated in their own things. But motivated doesn't mean that they're interfering with each other. They should be able to motivate and try to put a line where they wouldn't cross it, so that the other one wouldn't get, like, you know, wouldn't feel that they're inferior or superior. So that way, we try to see how both can be motivated, and also them have a healthy team building, which means to say that they will be in a team where they feel comfortable, or where they feel it's safe to be. Next, we also try to deal with anxiety. So when we try to deal with anxiety, we see how a person who is having anxiety actually will not be able to play better. So we try to reduce the anxiety by seeing the root causes of anxiety. So the next one is the last, that is a rehab, which I'm discussing. This is not the last, there are much more topics, but this is the last which I'm discussing for today. So rehab will have, it's majorly to do with injury. So it's a little negative kind of a set, not negative, but something which is, which you don't really find active players in. Rehab is something where they have come to take rest, or try to gain self-confidence, or try to get back into the field after an injury or after a failure. So rehab will be having a lot of recovery. Rehab will have a lot of athletes who are low in self-confidence, who have no idea what is going to happen next, who are kind of like, you know, I wouldn't say depressed, but who are not really happy about what's happening with them. So you have to be a little more sensitive to work in rehab. It's not an active field. It's more like you sit and talk. There's nothing that you can make them do. It's more like, you know, there's no activity as such you can make them do. Or you can't even tell them openly about, like, you know, sports and things, because their main worry is that, you know, will they be same when they come back to the sports? So this has a lot of psychology, which has a lot of counseling effects, where you try to be empathetic to them. You try to understand, you try to make them to gain confidence when they come back to the game, which is a very tough task, which is a very sensitive one, because if you try telling them in any other way, they might take it wrong. It's not that they are waiting to take it wrong, but they might, because they're in the position which is already a very disturbing thing to them. So this is the rehab. So now getting into the next one, it is how psychology, like, you know, actually works. How does it work, or what does it exactly do? So to be a better athlete, we should understand that, you know, it doesn't mean that you should train harder or longer. As I told you in the start of the session, it's not necessary for you to only keep training physically. You should also train yourself mentally. We know that there are athletes, let's take five athletes. So all five athletes who have trained 2 hours on an everyday basis, 2 hours morning and 2 hours evening, on an everyday basis, so total of 4 hours of training, they have got same training from same coaches, and they have been doing pretty much the same. But when they go to competition, there'll be one person who will excel, there'll be one person who will make an error, there'll be one person who would want to do better but will not be able to do. So all these changes that you see is not because they haven't trained, because you know they have trained the same way. But the reason for this is something which is related to psychology. What exactly were their thoughts when they were doing that kind of a activity? were they really mindful? Were they thinking of what I have to do or what I should do? Is something that they have to know. When the person is not aware what is going on with them by just doing training, like, you know, on the surface level every day, or trying to just increase the time in the training will not really help them, because maybe the physical thing is perfectly fine, but when it comes to the mental thing, maybe that's where they're actually getting affected. So this is one important thing. This is how you can say that psychology is important. So as a science, sports performance evolves, so it becomes increasingly important to integrate mental and physical aspect of the performance. As I told you, it's not just one, it's two component which comes together and works with the athlete. Traditionally, no attention has been given to cognitive aspects of performance, because we rarely think performance has anything to do with our mind and our thoughts, which is a very wrong thing. Actually, as I told you, 80% of your performance is decided by what kind of thoughts are going on in your mind. Coaches and athletes have devoted most of their attention to the physical components of the performance. The reason is that there is still lack of awareness, especially in sports psychology. The whole concept of psychology is something which is very wrongly taken by athletes. So when I go to athletes and talk to them about psychology, they will tell me that they don't really have any problems in their life. I would tell them, no, this is not for problem. This is not that I'm going to give you some solution kind of thing. I'm just here to improve your performance. They wouldn't somehow believe that they can actually improve the performance by talking to a sports psychologist. So as a person who is aiming to become a sports psychologist, you should remember that these are the shortcomings. In the first time, they wouldn't be happy to welcome you because they don't know how it works. It's quite simple, right? When we don't know what exactly it is, we wouldn't actually give any attention to it. We would think, why should we even need it? I think I'm fine. If I'm not really doing well, I think I have to talk to the coach and maybe start practicing more. This is what is then in their head. So you have to make sure that they are trusting you with your skills. So to start off with, you might have a lot of people who wouldn't be liking to work with you, but once they start seeing the result, they wouldn't let you go. They would call you before every other thing and tell you what is happening and will want your suggestions. So that's the thing. So then evaluation. So it can be easier and to evaluate a person based on the physical component. So why people don't really get into psychology is, again, because you can't really know what's happening in the person's mind, but you can definitely know what their one of the physical component. Let's say the heartbeat is. If you have to know heartbeats, you have to just test it using a machine. But can you know what thought is going on in a person's mind? No. So that's one more reason why people don't want to get into it, because they think it's a very complicated thing. But as psychologists, if we are trained to be psychologists, it is kind of easier for us because we know how to deal with people, and also will not be really judgmental. Whenever they say something, we wouldn't say, how dare you say that. Maybe a coach would be, not that he wants to be, but coach would have some kind of expectations out of the players. They would want that kind of things only to come out of it. When that doesn't happen, the coach will be angry, and it is important for him to be that way, because only then these people can give the best, the athletes can give the best. But the other side, if you see, a psychologist is someone who wouldn't be judgmental, who will be more than that empathetic. So when there's a failure, the psychologist will try to understand why the failure happens from a larger perspective of both physical and mental. But when it comes to coach will only try to concentrate on physical, saying that this error happened and that's why this happened. But they wouldn't see why that physical error happened. So that way, the reason, again, as I told you, it's difficult to evaluate. How will you actually count things which is happening in your mind? Or how will you count the anxiety? Or how will you count your concentration? And it's very different for different people. So how do you actually evaluate is a tough thing. That's the reason why people don't really get into psychology much. But also one more thing, they don't really think that, sports is something where they should have a holistic development. But we as psychologists, we should remember that they are also human beings, right? They also will have a lot of mental thing. In fact, they will have more issues rather than the general population. What we think, sports people who are active in sports, they are exercising, they are eating good food, they are under good coaches. So maybe they'll be fine, because that's what you need to be fine, right? Eat good food, get good sleep, get good training and be with good people, so you will be fine. But the stress that they go through is something which we don't really see. When they go through a failure, the way they take up themselves, the way they doubt themselves is something which we don't see, because all these things happen behind the screens. We don't really pay attention to it. So we don't really see the need of having a holistic development of a sports athlete. We try to see, oh my God, that person got a national award or got won a prize or won an Olympic medal. But we don't see what after that, the pressure which is created for them to keep that up. If they don't win next time, that means they are again going down. So the pressure itself for an athlete will be too much to handle. So these are the way we are supposed to think as psychologists, so that we will know how psychology helps the sports athletes. So now getting into the next one, why do we think sports psychology is important? So why do we need? So these are the different aspects why we would need sports psychology as. So sports psychology concentrates specifically on helping athletes break the mental barriers. So when I say mental barriers, I will take each of these and try to see how they actually can become a mental barrier. So if you see, first one is focus. So when the person isn't able to focus, so that time it improves the focus and it will deal with distraction. The very reason psychology being a subject which works with the mind, it knows how mind functions. And trust me when I say this, mind has a pattern of doing things. The only reason we don't know because we are not aware. We are not paying attention to what our thoughts are. But it has a pattern. So you think this way, this thought will come. If you think that way, that thought will come. So there's a pattern which goes on. So we as psychologists will try to help them to find out the pattern and break the pattern. So this is how we try to make sure that the distractions aren't happening. So when they are in the crowd, they're obviously when they're playing in big matches, if you see football or now the football is going on and cricket was going on till now, like now we have one more championship league coming up. So when we see all these things, now though it's at least Corona is there, so people aren't there too much. But when you actually see a crowded auditorium or a place where they're playing the crowded field, you can actually imagine the distractions that they might go through. And not that these people can't hear it. The fans will shout in such a way that the person can actually hear it. How can you stay in that place, hear everything, and still make sure that you're performing is a tough question where we try to help them by improving the focus. They are there to play the match, not really bother about what is happening behind. So we try to help them with that. So the next one is confidence. When it comes to confidence, so when there's focus and confidence, most of people try to confuse with each other. So focus is trying to gain attention, narrowing your attention to one particular thing is focus. And if you see concentration is when you try to go deeper into it. So when we talk about focus, I think about something with where you're trying to deal with one thing. As I told you, distraction comes from the fans. How to make sure that you're avoiding the distraction and trying to focus is focus. You're trying to focus there. We are trying to see you are making sure that attention is in one particular place. But when it comes to concentration, you are getting deeper into it where you're trying to see how you can improve the performance. So focus is being in the game and concentration is improving. So this way, there are two components, focus and concentration, where people usually misuse it. And when they misuse it, it's important for you as an psychologist to clear it to the athlete that focus is trying to pay attention to one thing and concentration will be going deeper into it. Then the next one is confidence. When it comes to confidence, how to grow your confidence in the athletes. So every time they achieve something better, yes, the confidence increases, but along with the confidence increase, there's also fear which increases, thinking that whether they'll be able to do better in the next time. The same way when they lose it, when they lose the match, they lose the confidence thinking, will I be able to do justice next time? Or what if I do the same kind of mistake? So at this particular time, it's important for us as a counselor or as a psychologist to help them, make them believe in themselves. So to tell them what other factors led to the failure, they would usually blame it on themselves, thinking that it's only me, because of me, I failed and I feel I'm not worth it. But that is one negative thought which can lead to a lot of negative thoughts. So we should make sure that we are cutting it then and there so that they'll be able to grow up their confidence and again come and play in the same way as they played before. Once they lose confidence, it's very hard for them to gain it back otherwise. So as psychologists, we would help them with that as well. Then you have coping skills. So coping skills are to do with your setbacks or maybe your failures or errors, because sports is a place where failure happens on an everyday basis. So you one match you can win, the other match you can lose. So losing is a part of the game, as we all know. So coping after losing a match is something which is very important, and not everyone are clear how to cope. They have different coping strategies, but are these coping strategies healthier one? Is it helping to grow them as a person is something which we try to talk. And then communication, we try to help communicate each other, maybe with the teammates or maybe the whole team with the coach. So we try to make sure that they have a good communication by making them have team games, by making them have sit and talk with each other, share each other's stories, get to know each other, and also know why the other person is saying this way. When they come to a team, especially when they come to a national team, there are people from throughout the country and they wouldn't have known their past or their history. So whenever someone talks, it's very difficult for the other one to connect. So that it becomes very difficult for them to actually be with each other, understand and play together, because they're from two different backgrounds. Being in one single family, at times we don't understand the other person in the same family. We feel it's so difficult to even think, why are they even that way? Imagine people who are come from different environments, different settings, different parenting. So to work, and their goal is one. So they have to work together. So that way communication becomes very important. So we work with them as well. Then we have motivation. Motivation, I'm sure you all know, we try to motivate them to make sure that they are getting into the optimal performance. That is nothing but the zone. So we motivate them. We don't really over-motivate, but motivate them to a certain level where they go into the zone. So to know the certain level, you should know the athlete before. So as I told you, injury we did talk about. So post-injury, people, especially the athletes, find that, you know, it's very difficult for them to come back. And once they come back, it's very difficult for them to believe in themselves. So that's where we try to work on. We have strategies where we try to see how strategies can be developed. So we sit with the coaches and we try to help them, because we would be knowing a lot of their mental state and coaches will be knowing the physical skills. We try to combine both of it and develop strategies which can be very much used during the game. The last but not the least one, we also help them enter the zone. As I told you, the zone is where they perform the best. So sports people would know when I talk about the zone, they wouldn't remember what exactly was with them, but they will perform brilliantly. Everyone who watches the match will be amazed by their performance. And it's not that they're working hard during that time. They're actually enjoying the whole thing that they're doing, but they'll get the best results. So entering zone is very hot topic of sports psychology, because they need to know how to enter the zone, because every time a player enters the game, he wants to be in the zone for maximum time and make sure he is giving the best to the game and the team. So knowing how to enter is something which the sports psychologist can help with. So getting to the last one, which involves careers in sports psychology, just to make sure that you will know what exactly to do when you get into sports psychology. Till now, you studied what we do, where we work, how we, what and all we have opportunities. Here, I'm going to crisply tell you, how these actually work. So there are three important or major things. These are all interconnected. Again, these are not separate fields, but these are three things which you can enter into as a sports psychologist. First one is research. So when I talk about research, I'm actually a part of research and teaching, both of it as of now, because I'm more trying to see how the different components of psychology is affecting the performance of an athlete. So that means I'm actually researching on it. But along with it, I also teach in a college about sports psychology. So I'm also into teaching. So research are the ones who are involved with doing research on field and trying to see why is research important. Until unless you don't know what is important for the performance, you wouldn't be able to go and consult them or give training. Without knowing what you're supposed to talk, if you go and stand in front of them, there's no use at all. So researchers are the backbone of the sports psychology, because once you do the research, you can actually say this is how it works and this is a training which I'm supposed to give. So to start off with, research is a very good thing, because only then you'll understand the gaps. When you know the gaps, it's not only helping you to grow as a person, it's also helping the athletes. If athletes already know how to make sure that, they are concentrating well, they're able to motivate well, if those are the topics which is already covered, and then you get trained on concentration, if you go and help them in concentration, they wouldn't want you. They would say that I already know how to concentrate. So teach me something new. So for that reason, it's important for you to get into research before anything else. So once you get into research, you will know the gaps. You will see that where exactly is that thing missing. So when you understand where exactly it is missing, you will know that this is where it is missing. So I have to work on this. And when you work on that, the results will actually amaze you that, you know, it's the right thing that you are working in a current field. And then that you can apply in the next one, which is the consulting one. So consulting one is the third important role. I wouldn't say that it's different from it. You can be a teacher, part-time teacher, and also consulting. You can also be a part-time consultant and a full-time teacher. So it's left to you. This field is as flexible as you can see it. So you can do all of it at once as well. You can also write papers because you're talking to athletes and you're consulting. You know what exactly might be things which are going on. So you might be a teacher teaching things and you try to apply that into the consulting. And when you apply that into consulting, you will find a result that can be published as a research. So all these three are intertwined, which I'm just trying to that there is a lot of scope in sports psychology. The only thing you need to get into it. And if you are from sports, if you are from the background of sports, it's even more easier for you because you already know what are the gaps. You already know what are the things which are lacking. So that will give you even more better understanding of where to go, what to do. So when people say sports psychology, does it really have any scope? It definitely has scope. It has a lot of scope, in fact. So that way, I would like to tell you that, you know, if you have to just enter it. Once you enter it, you will find 1,000 ways. And one more thing which can be challenging is convincing athletes that psychology actually helps is the first stage, which is most challenging. But once you get your stand, they would love you for what you are. They would want more of psychology from you. So that is one stage which you have to cross. I guess in every field, you have that kind of a challenging factor. Here, it's to work with the athletes because most of the athletes aren't aware. So you are creating awareness is the first thing. Once you create awareness, build a rapport, very good rapport with them. Once you build a rapport, you are into it. And once you start it off, there's no end to it. And this, you can start making it as your career. You can be a consulting person or you can just join teams. So I have known sports psychologists who have joined team and these teams will actually take them to wherever, whichever places they go. And they try to get the training at that particular places itself. So that can also be done. In abroad, these things are permanent jobs. In India, at least, it's not really permanent. It's still coming up. But definitely, government is very supportive in this. And government would want to explore much more opportunities. If you actually see a Sports Association of India, SAI, has always been like, you know, 3 months back, there was an opening for psychology. Every 6 months, they keep opening in new places and they would want sports psychologists to be appointed. So there's no nothing that, you know, you feel that there's no thought for you which has to come regarding the career, because career is almost very much there and it's very much flourishing. So that way, I would want to end my talk here about what I had prepared. I would just see if there are any questions so that I can answer it. Okay, I can see the chat. 1 second. So there's a question which asks how steroids and an intervention in the psychology sports person about to get into serious sports mode. So yeah, we have an exclusive study on drugs itself. And this is rehab. This is, again, it's connected to rehab. When it comes to the something related to drugs or the person getting into an unhealthy mode of, it's not just drugs, it's also nutrition, how they consume it. Someone says that this kind of a thing is good if they start overeating it just because they have to perform, that's also a bad thing. So all these things come under addiction. So we try to teach, we try to work with them during the rehab. So we will try to tell them about how the steroids, though it's a short-term goal which they want to achieve, and then we will try to see how it's not really the solution for the long-term thing. Because these people would think that, you know, they were only thinking of short terms and they're thinking that taking this will make me win it. But once they win it, what about the way the body is going to restore? We try to make them understand physically what is exactly happening in their body, which will actually affect them. So sports psychology, the books for sports psychology, there are a lot of books for sports psychology. One which would be, if you actually go to a website called as Human Kinetics, H-U-M-A-N, Kinetics, K-I-N-E-T-I-C-S. So there you will find a lot of books for sports psychologists. And every book has its own, good or bad, like good things about it. So you can try to make sure that you're going to that particular website and getting the information. Human Kinetics is something which you have to remember. That is one particular website where they have a lot of books on. They actually work for sports psychology. And okay, ma'am, if sports psychology includes educating general population about exercise, what is the difference between? Okay, health psychology, okay, when it comes to health psychology primarily tries to see how to reduce diseases, how to reduce the illness. In sports psychology, we are a little more ahead of them. We don't wait till the disease occurs or the illness occurs. We make sure that the prevention, we believe in the prevention. We try to say that how you are supposed to be healthy. If you have to be healthy, you are supposed to be into a physical exercise mode. We started from the school. So we are not working with the hospitals, but we are starting from the school and we are trying to tell them that start from here, give physical education, give the importance. So start hiring the person who is into physical education as well as psychology. So they can tell it, inculcate the things from the childhood so that the children won't play the game for the fun of it. But they also know that this is going to help me to be like, you know, healthy and fit throughout my life. So I have to continue. How many of us actually continue playing a game after school? Most of us would stop except for someone who is into the sports. So as sports psychologists, we should start it from the basic level to teach the school kids that this is not fun. It's giving out fun, yes, it's giving, making you happy, but this is more than what you think. So they have to start inculcating physical activity as their own. So health psychology would concentrate on the basically on the disorders and try to see how to how to treat the ill people and how the disease all occurs, all those things. We don't really concentrate much on those aspects. We try to prevent it very ahead of it. And then there was one more. Did I miss something out? If I have missed it, please post it again because it's coming fast. So there's something else. Can definitely post. Thank you so much. I'll send the slides. I'll send the link on the group. So you can just go through the slides again because I didn't really give time to read. So you can read it once again. But that's that's about it. Any questions, please to ask if there's any question. So sports psychology is really an upcoming field. I'm the proof for it because I'm not from a sports background. I have not been an active sports person who really played sports. But when I entered the area and then when I entered into the whole setting of sports, I understood how much it needs sports psychology. I have been in touch with athletes from past four to five years. And over these times, all I have found is the gap. That they need psychology and the psychologists don't know that there's something called a sports psychologist. So how to apply sports psychology? Sports psychology can be applied. As I told you, if you are someone who is okay being with sports people or athletes, if you feel it's comfortable to work with them, you can definitely apply it in the setting of sports. That means in the academies. So if you're in a place where there's an academy, you can directly go to the academy and try to see how it works. But if you're not really someone into sports psychology, you're not into sports and you don't really have the comfort level of talking to athletes, then definitely the next thing I would say is go do research on general population and try to see the difference of how and physical exercise is making a person feel and how a absence of physical exercise is making a person feel. Compare it. Try to know what it is. Give out the results and then spread the awareness to people who are not exercising, saying that these are the good benefits. Please try to act on it or please try to know what you can do about it. So that way you're trying to spread awareness. This is also a part of sports psychology, which we do. But only people who are into sports psychology know that these are the things which a sports psychologist will do because the others aren't aware. So please remember that is one important thing. So you can do that. And also there was someone who asked where can we pursue sports psychology. Yes, where can you pursue? There are a few number of colleges. There are MSc sports psychology. It's given in Punjab. Guru Nanak Dev University is one which offers. There's also one more government recognized university which is into sports itself, physical exercise and sports. You have sports psychology there as well. So if you are thinking of applying, these universities apply master. These universities give you masters in sports psychologist. And if you want a diploma course, it is, as I told you, it's there in Bangalore. It's in Jain University. We offer you a diploma in sports psychology, which is equivalent to any other diploma. And this will give you an exposure of how it can be worked. And what is the eligibility to go into sports psychology and start a career? So for you, you should have done your bachelor's in sports psychology. So it can be BSc in psychology or BA in psychology. So that is one. But if you're wanting to join, that is for master's in sports psychology. If you're wanting to join diploma, there's no need for basic psychology as well, because we will teach you basic psychology from the start. So we have a lot of people who are non-psychologists, but we are training them. So a lot of sports athletes come into diploma into sports psychology. And is there any master's course established in sports psychology in leading university? Yes. As I told you, it's one Guru Nanak Dev University. Please try that. There's one institute, national institute, which is for sports. So try that as well. And what is mental game coaching or mental training? So mental game coaching or mental training comes under sports psychology. It is basically to do with training your mind to make sure that you're able to concentrate and focus. So here we try to first study the athlete. We try to see what the athlete is. And then we develop strategies specifically for the athletes to help them mentally train, like, you know, to get maybe the arousal, when they have to be aroused so that they can perform well. Where should their anxiety level stop? Why shouldn't increase? How to make sure that it's not increasing after a point? Because if it is below, again, they are too lazy. If it is very high, again, they are very active. So it should be in an optimal level. So to go into an optimal level, we teach them a mental training or mental strategy. So that's the way. Mental strategy is a mental planning of how to make sure that this will only happen when we start working with them on a continuous basis. We can't apply everything to everyone because it doesn't work that way. Every athlete has a different way of working. So that's about it, I guess. Yes, it's one. We are done. So thank you so much for being there and watching it. And thank you for the questions. And thank you, Chanakya, for giving me a chance to talk to them. So I guess that's done.